We're rolling. Can I say that again? No? No caveats. No excuses. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a special edition of Adam versus the Man, Libertarian Leadership Roundtable. And yes, Mike, you're I think, the third one to point out in this series so far. This is only the second episode in the series that this is not actually a roundtable. So thank you for your originality tonight. But no, I'm here with three people I have an immense amount of respect for as activists. We are at the Arizona State Libertarian Party Convention. As Mike was pointing out right before we started rolling, it has been a long day for a lot of us. But Arizona, we like to bust it out here, and one day of business, we got everything done. It was a well-run convention. And Mike, as the fellow local and someone who's been involved with the state party, you are also recently announced a candidate for chair of the Libertarian Party. So thank you for stepping up. I should point out we are in No Force One with a live studio audience, and we are going to be passing around some cannabis and getting everybody riled up. So if you hear chip shots from the cheap seats, I got it right that time. Yes, all right. That's it. We have a live studio audience here in No Force One. But I want to give Mike first thoughts on today, and then you know your resume as well. And I know you've had. You've had a lot of different titles within the Libertarian Party.
So thoughts on the day and my resume?
Yeah, sure. Let's start with that.
One long monologue.
Well, my don't worry, we'll interrupt.
Okay, cool.
And so will they.
Well, you know, I knew it was a presidential year, and I wasn't sure that we would really have enough room because I knew there were more people coming than we typically expect. So I was pleasantly surprised that there were enough seats for everything, and we weren't like stuffed in a tiny little room. Like,
it was very comfortable.
So, yeah, it was really nice. I liked the vibe, the ambiance, the like art on the wall was a nice touch.
And
it's beautiful. The speakers were interesting. One of them is even here at the table with us. And it was fantastic. We picked our delegates, and you know, other than that, it was pretty much a standard state convention scenario.
All right, and your background. What's your role? You had how many different? You're currently the first vice chair.
Is this where I confess my dirty little secret?
That yes.
Ron Paul converted me.
Oh, we're going straight to that. Zach has some Ron Paul history. We're gonna come back to that.
All right. Well, so picture it. Phoenix, 2006. So I was a liberal Democrat, and I wanted to learn how to shoot guns because I literally thought George Bush was going to come murder us all.
A lot of people did.
But like, I didn't know where to find other people like me to shoot with. So, and I was starting to be skeptical of the Democrats and what they were saying to us. So I got online, and I found out there was this group called the Pink Pistols, but we didn't have a chapter in my city. So you know me, I just started one. And it turns out that's libertarianism. And libertarians came to my club and started like talking to me, and I learned how to shoot. And you know, next thing you know, it's 2007 and Ron Paul was happening. So I'll make the rest of the story short. You know, within a few years, I had been to my first convention, and I was elected chair of Outright Libertarians, which is the gender and sexual minority caucus in the party in 2014.
Can I interrupt about that? Because that's the you just skipped over something really important that I think hasn't quite taken hold as it should have. GSM is a term, and I first heard this from you because you did one of the weekly national conference calls and just explaining this term GSM, gender sexual minorities. Why should libertarians use that? Why is it superior to LGBT alphabet soup?
Well, so you know, liberal politics are. They get the like identity script kind of flipped, right? Because it's really about your individual experience of oppression, and like identity does shape how we experience authoritarian systems. But their solution to that is to like build systems of control around identity. And what happened with gender and sexual minority people is that they just started like you know, at first it was just gay people, and then, oh my gosh, we forgot lesbians, so it's gays and lesbians, and wait, that's misogynist, should lesbians be first? And like, this giant power struggle unfolded for like decades over who should be in the acronym, what the letters should mean. Suddenly pangender and poly people are fighting over the P and which P goes first, and who, how do you even know? It's just a P. So we have to have two P's, and so now it's LGBTQIAPP+, like, I mean,
oh mercy.
And eventually gets absurd, right? That is the predictable result of liberal identity politics. You can never be inclusive enough to just include the individual, which is the libertarian perspective. I don't need to justify my identity to you in order to have rights. So we in outright libertarians kind of looked at that problem, and we actually resurrected gender and sexual minority was a acronym, I guess is the word, that, or like a phrase that's floated around in the early 70s, and it just kind of went away because LGBT became the mainstream one.
That's what the media wanted.
Yeah, so we brought it back because we're like, this is, it never needs to change. You don't need to add letters. It's always everybody. And it even encompasses, you know, quote, deviant sexualities that aren't included by the acronym. Just BDSM, kink in general, even
well,
sex
technically
work.
It's everybody. I mean, straight, white,
anybody.
Cis male is a minority, right. And it's saying, it's even embracing the, you have the same right to, that does, it transcends, it's a way of transcending
yeah.
all discrimination
I mean,
based
everyone
on
has a kink.
Sex or sex orientation.
Yeah. So.
Well, and you don't want to be super specific and hey, that's your bedroom, that's your private time. So to have to identify yourself down to that letter, that
right.
one, that's real intrusive, and it's got to be uncomfortable. You're bringing your bedroom antics out to the public, and I feel like it's the exact opposite of what we want. We want privacy, right?
So Mike Shipley,
unless you're an exhibitionist,
is there anything else you need to lay out for? I want to come back and we're going to get your platform essentially for chair. Is there anything else you want to say by way of introduction at this point?
Oh, I mean, we just scratched the surface of the resume, but...
How many years do you have of libertarian activism?
At this point, it's... If it was in 2007, it'd be 13.
That's the same as me.
Oh, my God. Oh!
We're
libertarian bros.
Yeah, no, it was I can actually pinpoint like my start in full-time activism to the first IVAW march, March 19, 2007. So yeah, it's been 13 years.
Almost. Yeah, I remember because we were in Ernie's like workshop that he had, and like your YouTube videos were popular with people.
Yeah. Anyway, all right, so. Joie Leigh, G.I. Mary Jane.
G.I. Mary Jane, the Commander in Chief. I head up Civilian Platoon 420. We report the drug war news from the perspective of the victims. It's not an arrest, it's a human abduction, and it's not a raid, it's a home invasion. I'm former Director of Outreach for Maryland's Chapter of Normal. I've lobbied on the state and federal levels, and Bob Goodlatte was awesome enough to present me with the Architect of the Capitol Award in 2018 for my efforts. They raised a flag for me at the Capitol on 420 on July 4th, and my probation officer wouldn't let me go. So I couldn't go accept this award for being so generous to my community, which is supposedly what they want in this reform system. So that's me. That is I.
Well, there's one other aspect of your story that I don't know if you want to get into now, but I definitely want to ask you about it, is your family law issue, because with the presidential campaign, one of the things I'm excited about, and this is really beyond my campaign, but we have victims of family law for Kokesh, and you know, if everybody in this country who has been through a shitty divorce or known someone who has, or had someone in their immediate family, or been the child of divorce, or dealt with child custody, or worrying about CPS taking their kids because they smoke weed, you know, or like the story you just reported on today, I know this is going to another extreme, but where the suspicion of cannabis possession led to a 3-year-old kid getting shot in a no-knock raid, just
shot in the
insane
back.
But that if everybody, this victims of family law idea, it's a black swan waiting to happen. If every American who is affected by this realized and was able to overcome the shame and the guilt and the bullying into silence associated with this. And your story is really powerful.
Well, it's funny, and you're, I think when you say everybody who's been affected, I think there isn't anybody who hasn't been affected. Because even if it didn't happen to your family, your friends, you know, parents broke up, and it affected your friendship as a kid with your little buddy. I mean, we've all been affected. My personal story, I'm being forced to be on a supervised visitation with my only son in a Virginia state custody court. I'm a legal cannabis patient in Maryland when all this started. I've moved to Colorado for sanctuary. As a lot of people do to these legal states. And I'm not allowed to see my son because I'm considered dangerous because I did what the government wanted. I got my paperwork. I did everything I was supposed to. I paid the fee in two different states. And it's costing me. And I'm not the only one. I've actually spoken to somebody who's was separated from their child years ago for selling edibles. Child got sent to foster care, died in foster care, and the woman who's responsible is actually out of jail now while this guy still sits there in prison. So yeah, the family law thing, it really is the black swan. Like, we're pre-programmed to be shameful if they take our kids. We're supposed to believe that we're a bad parent if we don't get that custodial parent label. And it's just not the case. And because of that, people choose not to talk about it. And we all know how unhealthy that is. So yeah, the Victims of Family Law Coalition is amazing. And I think it crosses with all of the other coalitions that are forming around your campaign in that, for one reason or the other, you're affected because of, you know, regulatory issues that are telling you based on somebody's... Oh, we have guests.
Our next guest is here. All right, we want to just squeeze in, Caryn. Why don't you bring that chair and just slide in here?
Hello.
You can squeeze in a little bit.
Is it yours?
We're still in introductions. And now, hold on, you want to get the chair that doesn't rock right there. Ladies and gentlemen, Caryn Ann Harlos, Libertarian National Committee Secretary in the house.
Hey.
It's looking fab.
If you can squeeze into the shot. And this mic will
take everybody
else.
Tell
me
where to go.
All right, well, hold on. So on that note, though, let's go to Zach Foster for your introduction. I will adjust the shot. Are you partaking tonight?
Oh, no, I don't partake.
Okay, well, the idea is to get me to talk as little as possible. So, Zach, take it away.
Okay. I'm Zach Foster. I'm the executive director of the Mises Bombay Institute of Cuba. That's Cuba's Mises Institute. And one of the main reasons for the hybrid name is we're not just a think tank. Yes, we produce new academic content, but we're also an incubator for libertarian activism on the ground behind the Iron Curtain. And the countries that we focus the majority of our resources on are Cuba and Venezuela. Well, a lot of people immediately ask me, what are we doing getting involved with people in other countries or political issues in other countries? And I said, well, the world is changing. For starters, I need to just throw the disclaimer out there. I am not an interventionist. I do not believe that the U.S. government should be out there solving the world's problems because usually the U.S. government does a very bad job. That said, I originally got involved with Cuban libertarians when a Cuban libertarian who was a refugee recently arrived in Miami asked for help because two of his friends, in Havana got arrested by state security, which is kind of like their FBI and the NSA rolled into one crappy organization. So the official charge was attempted assault of a police officer, but really what it was having the wrong books and then not showing their IDs when their IDs were demanded by these two rando guys in civilian clothes. You know, who were they? The more that I got involved in just helping these Cuban libertarians get the word out, as a matter of fact, Caryn Ann Harlos was one of the people who was instrumental in the Libertarian Party taking an official position as far as the Cuban libertarians and the Castro government's repression against political dissidents. And again, the criticisms came from folks who were not fans of that. They said, again, why are we intervening in other countries? I said, yeah, this is not an intervention in another country. There is a difference between, all of a sudden slapping embargoes or trade sanctions on a country. There is a difference between sending the 82nd Airborne Division to go pacify a country and change its government versus what we're doing, which is just putting something on blast in a public forum. So that's how I originally got involved with Cuban libertarians. I found out there was a small group. They asked me for help. You know, the more that they talked, the more I knew this was not some Nigerian prince scam, because they never asked me for money. They kept wanting to denounce to the media and to the United Nations and to Amnesty International what was happening to their libertarian comrades. So the more that we worked with the Cuban libertarians, my volunteer team and I, the more that we found out about the horrible repression and poverty and just the general dumpster fire of a situation that was happening in Venezuela. And the reason why we wanted to get involved in helping the Venezuelan libertarians is because the Cuban government, which the same Cuban regime that oppresses our libertarians in Cuba, also has a military occupation of Venezuela happening right now, where you actually have Cuban soldiers in Venezuelan uniforms shooting at unarmed protesters. So in the name of the Cuban libertarians, we extended support to the Venezuelan libertarians. And next thing you know, we're at the level where different members of the Libertarian Party have been deeply involved. Other members of the Libertarian Party have been involved in helping recruit volunteer fighters who would be interested in going down there once they got the green light. Dr. Kyle Varner, who's a very active party member, has actually been to Colombia multiple times.
Also spoke at the convention today.
Yeah, he also spoke today. He's been at the Colombian-Venezuelan border multiple times, doing medical work, pro bono medical work at a refugee clinic. And there are just thousands and thousands of refugees that flood into that border every day. So we are not looking for the United States government to be the world police. Just the thing is, the Cuban government is not only waging a war on its own activists at home, to the point where activists do disappear all the time. They do get murdered all the time. And whenever the police want or the government wants plausible deniability, what they'll do is they'll put political prisoners like Ubaldo, who's one of the guys that got arrested in 2017, they'll put the political prisoners in with the general population, and then, you know, one of the COs will let one of the gang members know, hey, there's going to be a riot today, you know, good luck. And then next thing you know, unfortunately, you know, this political prisoner got stabbed in the riot. That was an accident. You know, the government had nothing to do with it. It was just an unfortunate circumstance. So the same regime that's waging war on libertarians and other dissidents in Cuba is also waging a literal war in Venezuela, to the point where not only are they shooting unarmed protesters, but they've actually deployed the armed forces and the civilian paramilitaries to go and do massacres. As a matter of fact, the Maduro regime restarted the Indian Wars. And this is something that has affected capital L libertarians in Venezuela. For example, my friend Jesus Noria, during the April 30th uprising, he was out there marching in the streets. He was wearing his yellow porcupine t-shirt when one of the civilian paramilitaries grabbed him, and then they detained him and brought him to the army, and they beat the crap out of him. Mm. And I've seen the photos of the black eye he had. The dude lost 50% of the vision in his right eye because of his libertarian activism. How many of us can say that that's happened to us? So because these people are being so oppressed as individuals, but also collectively as a group by this regime, you know, again, I'm not trying to get Uncle Sam to be the world's policeman. I see the world as a Game of Thrones type of world where there are multiple corrupt, greedy kingdoms trying to conquer other kingdoms. So yeah, you know, the US government and its organs have been one of those kingdoms, but you know, so is the Castro regime. They have been in more wars and more countries than you could imagine. Africa, Latin America, and apart from Venezuela, they also have troops in Nicaragua wearing Nicaraguan uniforms. And they had intelligence agents in Bolivia, Ecuador, and Chile fanning a lot of the Stalinists and some of the more militant ANCOMs into doing things like literally destroying the entire metro of Santiago. So we as individuals got involved in this fight because individuals asked us. So we are doing this as free individuals. We don't want Uncle Sam to get involved. We want other individuals to make the decision to get involved in this struggle to support our brothers who believe the same things we do, and they're getting oppressed for doing the same things that we do. So real quick, last thing of the introduction, CubanLibertarians.org if people want to see our website.
So Zach, I've heard you working on this since we spoke
beginning.
Together at an event in
2017
in Miami.
Yes,
like 3 years ago
at the Versailles restaurant.
Yeah,
there was a lot of Cuban Americans in the LP. That was pretty.
Yeah, epic. No, Florida LP is like actually.
Yeah, fun story
Cuban
about
Americans overrepresenting there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. As a matter of fact, we got Martha Bueno, who is. I forget what her position is right now. I think she's still on the XCOM of Miami-Dade County, if not the state party. She just got elected to town council in the last election, so she's a Cuban-American who actually does not have that much of a fond affinity for Cuba because she grew up in Venezuela. So,
I mean, don't you think the U.S. is kind of headed that way? I mean, to go back to that one story, a drug raid has a three-year-old in the hospital with a bullet wound to the back. You've got, we were just reading before we started recording, some vandal in Phoenix that's been painting phallic images all over town was just picked up by SWAT, 25 SWAT members for vandalizing.
Well, that's a lot for a troll with a spray paint can.
But I mean, do you think that tyranny that they're seeing is kind of where we're heading right now?
I would say yes and no, and there's one crucial difference, because the more that I work with these people fighting the corrupt regimes down there, and the more I see the crap that those governments are doing down there, the easier it is to identify when our different levels of government try to do some similar things here. I mean, for example, yeah, there's a lot of people who have been shot without any kind of due process. You know, maybe they were threatening the officer, maybe they weren't. There's a lot of good cops who get silenced. They're not able to report they're the bad cops because, you know, the bad cops will murder them or the bad cops will ruin their career.
It's true.
So a lot of them keep silent out of fear, and you know, the bad cops, unfortunately, you know, they're wreaking a lot of havoc. But you see it at different levels of government. For example, in Venezuela in 2018, Nicolas Maduro handpicked all the opposition candidates who were going to run against him in that fake election that was not called by the Congress, but by the fake, the parallel Congress that Maduro, you know, made to stay in power. But then the same year that was going on, right here, the chairman of the Arizona Republican Party sued the Kevin McCormick campaign. He was a Libertarian running for governor. The dude raised $200,000 as a Libertarian. That's a big deal. After that happened, they sued him, and they brought it directly to the Superior Court, and the Secretary of State was one of the witnesses. And the government line, which all these government people happen to be Republicans, you know, surprise, surprise. But we saw this example of these dudes. Obviously, they're using the power of the state to enforce their crooked political bias in an election, and they said some BS that 90% of the signatures that the LP collected were not valid, which ended up not being true. The McCormick campaign and other LP members went by and hand researched every single registered voter, and yes, they were valid Libertarian voters. Just, you know, the government decided we were not going to participate in that state election because the Republicans did not want any Libertarians to rock the boat for Daddy Trump. And I saw that happening over here, and that was heinous. That infuriated me. But one of the factors that makes us different from down there is here people still have their guns. In Venezuela, Chavez's government systematically went house to house disarming people, and the only people that ended up with weapons were the government and then the civilian paramilitary groups that were specifically loyal to the regime. What's different here is we've had events like the Bundy Ranch incidents, and then the other thing that they did up there at the wildlife refuge in Oregon, where they actually the armed population formed temporary armies to stand against the government, and just the fact that they presented that credible threat, they did not end up having to use it. The government backed down. You know, the government definitely backed down from the armed standoff at Bundy Ranch, and they had to back down from the armed standoff in Oregon and then use the courts to go back and get them later, and then they ended up getting found not guilty. So the fact that we still have that one last line of defense is probably the one key factor that's going to keep us from completely sliding down into that hell.
And killdozers. I think killdozers is the other important. The Second Amendment should say the right to keep and bear.
Does everybody know the killdozer?
The killdozer is a
no gentleman. Way.
Way.
No way. You know the killdozer, right? Anybody else?
Colorado.
This guy in Granby, Colorado, who had a muffler shop and was getting screwed over by the city zoning guys who let a cement factory go in next door and basically got put out of business, got this giant Komatsu bulldozer, and up-armored it with huge slabs of cement he had to have lowered onto the cab, and he went on a rampage through town. And he actually went head-to-head with another bulldozer that tried to stop him, and just clobbered him and pushed him out of the way. And
he put in,
I know, every libertarian, I'm thinking of getting a tattoo, like a memorial, like,
you
remember
should.
The killdozer.
But that was in Colorado.
This, yeah, this is in Granby, Colorado. I think it was in the 90s.
And he built it as such, so it was a kamikaze mission to begin with. Built it so they could not get
it. Well, you're jumping ahead.
No, they were LARPing Transformers.
He went and he demolished the businesses owned by the people who were using the city law against him. He went and demolished City Hall. And he had cops literally crawling all over the killdozer, trying to throw smoke grenades in the exhaust. Nothing would stop the killdozer. Kept going. The only way, he fired his he had machine guns, and he had it built in so that he had cameras to see out. It was all visually sealed in, and it had an air recirculation system. I mean, this thing was well thought out.
He was like engineer of the year.
A bulldozer, like a massive bulldozer. And the only thing that stopped him was that at the last building he hit, he fell into the basement and was stuck. And at that point, he decided that with his handgun, he would take his own life. And that was
2004.
Relatively recent, 2004.
That's pretty epic.
John Heemeyer, right? Is that the name? Yeah, John Heemeyer. Marvin Heemeyer. Yeah. Remember the kill? I mean, that should be legend. That should,
okay,
like,
so
you want to talk about a check on government power?
Didn't
no.
Hurt anybody.
We don't need arms.
Just in terms of context to other kids, we don't want to go to the killdozer just because we're having like a minor disagreement with the city council. But when that is your last recourse against a corrupt government, then yeah, go for it.
It didn't hurt
anybody.
That was,
no.
Yes, thank
no
you.
Loss of life.
No loss of life, no injuries.
Got hurt.
Yeah.
And just retaliatory property damage. Yeah.
Which is, and I mean, I wouldn't condone the property damage, but in a situation where it's in, they ruined his life.
If you lose your mind, you have sense enough to ruin property instead of somebody's life, then
yeah. I think that's a great check on government power. Now, if your city council is out of control, Get yourself a killdozer.
Get yourself together.
Yeah, you know what's right, funny is because we talk about our really radical solutions for defense and, you know, our armed responses to the government. You know, a lot of the mainstream political people and the wonks like to talk about how crazy we libertarians are and how radical we are. But when you look at the actual people who are doing domestic terrorism because of their political beliefs, almost every single one of them, at least in the last 3 years, has been a Trumplican. Mm. I'm talking about the Charlottesville people. I'm talking about the stripper guy who tried to bomb Nancy Pelosi and Obama down in Florida. Multiple the synagogue shooter up in, I think he was in New York. He did it specifically because, you know, this synagogue supports open immigration policy and things like that.
Yeah.
The libertarians haven't done shit. It's always been Republicans. Republicans are almost always the terrorists. Sorry, that's just the way it is.
All right, well, before we get any more partisan, let's give Caryn Ann a chance to introduce herself, the Secretary of the Libertarian
National
Committee.
Did Mike already go?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, I missed it.
It's okay. You know Mike.
You
better know Mike.
I do know Mike.
All right, so
what is it that you want to know?
Well, first, how long have you been involved? Well, Caryn Ann has a very special role in the party besides being the Secretary, which is like, and I'm trying to figure out a way to say this is not a Mad Men reference, but you don't have a secretary personality. You know,
I actually
I know that you have a certain meticulousness about you, but what makes you, what gives you a special role in the party is not that you're the secretary, that is a relatively functionary role, and you have a voice in the LNC that's very important, and that's more significant. But I think what's really special is that you are the keeper of the records. And I forget what your title is at the moment, but head of the historical
chair
committee. Okay.
Yeah, the records whisperer.
Don't like labels. And I'm like, I have a whole trunk in my shipping container at home of stuff going back to the Ron Paul days of like
Are
autograph
you
programs
it to me?
And Eventually.
Thank you for your donation.
Yeah. Okay. Well, now when we go home, Joie, we got to go through this trunk and see what's appropriate. But yeah, your presentation of it was the second printing of the Statement of Principles with the coffee stains on it.
That was the original.
That was the original.
Yes, that was the original.
I've seen you do that 3 times, and it's thrilling every time. I'm that kind of nerd.
Shall be in the Smithsonian one day.
And it's actually going to... There's, you know that... Oh, Lord, who was... Hosper's book, Libertarianism, A Political Philosophy for Tomorrow. His students are re-releasing it. And that Statement of Principles story is going to be in the foreword.
Mm.
So I got asked to do that for that book, which was a big honor.
Very cool.
Can you recite the Statement of Principles?
Not right now. I'm very tired. I could almost.
I had to pull it up in the debate to read.
I could get it 80%.
I know the points, right?
Yeah, I could get it 80%.
But
right.
What is it? Really is a beautiful. I've heard. Libertarian state conventions started. The last place I heard this was Pennsylvania, where they started.
Well, that's Steve Sheets, because you know.
Steve Sheets is awesome. We're going to get him on this.
He's the bomb digging. Yeah,
it wasn't him, but he. I guess he was designing the program, but he had the opening of the state convention was a religious reading of the Statement of Principles.
Perfect.
Like, it's just. I think every state convention should start that way. It takes 4 minutes.
Something about
like
4 minutes, yeah.
And it's, yes, it makes every libertarian is hearing that is going, yes, yes, yes. Like, to be able to work it in today, like, I feel like I don't have to reinvent anything. But what's the significance of it, and what caught your attention and made this worthy of your effort to understand?
Can I get to that one sec? I want to say one thing to Zach.
Oh.
Well, just because you might not have known why I was so receptive to your message, I'm from South Florida. So I've always been around Cuban people and had a big heart for what goes on. You know, I started through the Muriel boat lift, I was there my whole life. So that's why you wonder why this Colorado person was just so interested in, you know, the plight of the Cubans. I grew up around that.
Well, that's really cool. I had no idea about that. I just thought you were really down.
No, I'm very familiar with it. And, like, my lifelong dream is to learn Spanish. I just think it's one of the most beautiful languages in the world. I just love it. So I just wanted to let you know what the connection was there.
It's pretty cool.
So that really sparked my interest. So the Statement of Principles.
Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah. The Statement of Principles, what was the question? Why is it so important?
Well, what really caught your attention about it? Like, well, why has it been, I mean, or the history of the LP in general? Okay. Like, what's the draw?
Well, unfortunately, the importance of the Statement of Principles has been downplayed. It used to be that every piece of literature that got put out by the party had to have the Statement of Principles on it. And I think we need to go back to that. Yeah. Obviously, it wasn't little business cards or whatever, but, you know, brochures, anything big enough that would warrant it. Every LP News used to have it. Every brochure used to have it. And we don't do that anymore. And I think that's nuts if you look at our bylaws. When people say you can't define libertarianism, maybe small l, it's much broader, but big L libertarianism has a definition in our bylaws, and it's a statement of principles. Like, absolutely, without a doubt, it says, you know, that's the philosophy upon which we were founded, through which we shall be sustained, and through which liberty shall prevail. I mean, you can't get any stronger than that. People like to point to the platform. The platform isn't really what the LP believes. The Statement of Principles is obviously a platform, can't contradict it, but the platform doesn't have to go as far. It'll have interim steps. So when people will point to the platform and say, well, it doesn't say taxation is theft.
The platform would be like a collection of resolutions.
Right, that are for now.
And could be issue by issue and as precise or as imprecise as we care to be.
We could get rid of the platform and we still have the Statement of Principles.
Or they could be like California and delete their platform.
Oh, no, they didn't win that.
Accident. Is that not how that finally played out?
No.
This is like a really dorky inside baseball LP story.
Hey, I wrote the brief for that.
So that got overturned.
Yeah.
But see, did you catch how much I cared?
I cared.
No, but the California State Party allegedly, apparently you're saying that this was procedurally incorrect and was overturned.
Procedurally incorrect.
But that they, I still geek out on this. I still think this is really fun.
I can tell you the two reasons why.
To make sure everybody knows the stories, there was an effort to redo the entire platform basically in one procedure, and they did the first part of erasing the platform with a higher
delete.
Yeah, they basically succeeded in deleting the platform and didn't succeed in replacing it. And at the end of the convention, everybody was like, "Oh, whoops, we don't have a platform now." Caryn Ann came in and fixed it on a technicality, fortunately.
Well, the bylaws are
Yeah. Okay, Berman was that's why I pay attention to the business meetings. Like, stuff like that happens and you go,
I'm a voting member now. You don't have to beg for me to get a speaking spot.
Okay, good. So you and me lifetime national.
Yeah, lifetime.
But no, that's for California the first time.
I'm going for a delegate seat with California.
Same here. Excellent.
So, but the way it won, if I remember correctly, was your guys' bylaws say things have to be done plank by plank. And the whole reason that was written is so you couldn't wholesale delete. You can't get around that. You can't even get around bylaws by a unanimous decision. The bylaws are the bylaws. So that was number one. And number two was the statement that people could not change.
That's like the least libertarian thing I've ever heard you say.
What?
The bylaws are the bylaws.
They are. It's a contract. But
with the majority, to go back to the statement of principles, because this I think is more important, is that the 7/8 rule.
Okay.
That it can't be changed unless you have 7/8 agreement of delegates at the national convention.
Registered delegates.
Right.
There's a difference.
Okay. See. All right.
Okay. 7/8 would just mean 7/8 of people voting. You can only have
of all registered delegates.
And we never have 7/8 of registered delegates on the floor at any given time.
Right.
So it's a super, super majority and a super, super quorum.
Yeah.
Which, you know, that's heresy when it comes to Roberts. But Roberts is just concerned with the survival of an organization qua organization. We're more concerned with the survival of the ideology. So that's why that was put in. And you want to know, that was the Statement of Principles was passed unanimously in 1972. It's probably the only time anything was ever passed unanimously by libertarians. That one guy, he must have been in the bathroom.
That one guy. Okay, so before Caryn Ann and I get way far down the party technical rabbit hole, because we could do this for the rest of the hour, but to someone who's totally new to the party, then I would turn to Joie. Like, you see this. This is, you know, working on a campaign, working the delegate process, traveling the country, new to this organization. First of all, do you have any experience with the old parties?
No. Okay. No, I've always identified more with libertarians, looking into it, but coming from the cannabis community, I can't stand politics. It's so tiring. I walk away. It's a trigger. It's like an abusive ex-boyfriend. I'm not going to come near you. I'm not even going to look at you. I won't look at the news. I'm not going to do it. But you know, you see in the age of Facebook and whatnot, you can't avoid it. Ron Paul, my first time I voted was the first and only time I voted for the president was for a libertarian. It was Johnson last term, it's weird. And I've never wanted to identify because I don't like labels, but that's so much the core of what the Libertarian Party stands for, is not necessarily labeling people as one thing or another. So I'm comfortable identifying with it, if that's even the right word.
What are your impressions of the organization? And the stuff that Caryn Ann is touching on, someone who's like that. You're sitting next to the embodiment of the historical awareness of the party right here, who's active at the highest level of functional of the national organization. Like,
and I also hate politics, and I didn't vote before I became a libertarian.
Yeah, that's right where I'm at. I'm impressed by the passion within the whole organization. You were talking about the libertarians in Cuba that called you and they just wanted exposure, they didn't want money. That's what I see in this entire party. I see...
Well, we'll take some money.
Let me back up. We all need money,
responsibilities.
Right? No, but there's a better understanding of resources and how to utilize them within this party, and that's above and beyond anything else, you know, aside from your freedoms and your liberties. That's what I see, and that's what's most impressive.
How long have you been a libertarian now?
Registered just this year.
Awesome.
Yes. I've converted. Is there a, do we do like a ceremony or something?
Do you know the secret handshake?
We're doing a ceremony right now.
Is it like a Bilderberg thing?
What I'm actually curious to ask Caryn Ann, as the official historical guru, what do you think about all of Murray Rothbard's editorials about the party, where he, you know, 50% of libertarian form, I feel, is him offering insights on current event, and the other 50% is just Rothbard bitching about things that happen at libertarian party meetings.
Yeah, but
which are entertaining. I love them. I love.
Well,
I love reading
them. 50% of what I say is bitching about what happens at libertarian party meetings, so it's a kindred spirit.
It's a circle of life.
You know, what would libertarians be without that? I mean, I think bitching is our superpower.
call it open communication.
Yes.
Creative open communication.
Passionate dialogue.
With negative overtones.
She doesn't like politics.
Yeah, anytime this comes up, we have to point out.
That scares you.
You think you're way too involved in Facebook. You're all way too involved.
I'm not much anymore.
No, because you used to be.
I used to be.
Yeah. Oh
my God. I used to be.
But it's like it brings out the worst in people and like the way that politics
brings out. I deactivated my account and then, you know, so I went through detox and then I was fine.
Did you reactivate
it? I reactivated it, but now I'm good.
You're like low level of
engagement. I go to Instagram a little bit and that's it.
Yeah. No, I think it's really important to point out that as you notice as a newcomer that there's a certain amount of passion, and a lot of it is, well, I figured out ethics and now I'm right about everything, and if you're not agreeing with me on everything, you're advocating for something unethical, and that cuts really deep.
And you're a bad person.
Yeah, and you're a bad person.
And you're not a real libertarian.
Well, if you don't think you're the only real libertarian, you're not a real libertarian, obviously. But yeah, I think it's worth always pointing out most of the conflict in the movement is silly.
No, what it, like, this is what it is. I've got the explanation if you want to know.
Ooh.
Since we don't believe in violence, we get out all of our aggressions. Since we can't punch people in the face, we get out all of the aggressions through the
I think that's where I have to plug the punk rock mosh pit material.
Well, this is the perfect transition. Hold on, I want to like fully shift focus.
I feel like
to Shipley here, because just announced that you're running for chair of the LP. This is a central issue.
I want to push back on the idea that we should internalize some shame for voicing things that matter to us. That infighting narrative is kind of, it's an attempt to say that what I'm telling you the narrative should be the whole narrative. It's an attempt to shut down dialogue. If I tell you you're infighting and I'm trying to instill a shame on you so that you stop speaking, I'm authoritarian, if that's a word, you know, your voice.
So you're taking the pro-infighting position.
So it's
there's a healthy kind of infighting of conflict that should be just embraced as part of it. Well,
we're conditioned by a society that glorifies authoritarian control over our voice. So when we discover our voices, you should give that person all the room they need to blossom into their being. And that necessarily implies a period of expression, of bold, passionate, sometimes awkward, and sometimes combative expression, because that is bottled up inside you. And when you finally discover your agency after a lifetime of having been conditioned to hold it in the name of compliance, obedience, conformity, suddenly you find your voice and you want to speak.
Yeah,
and I think that's one of our greatest strengths. Mm. And when we frame that as infighting, we're essentially shaming our new people in their moment of glory.
Wow. Now, see, I put that as directly as possible. Say you're taking the pro infighting position.
Well, I didn't say pro infighting.
Right. I'm really glad I put you on the spot like that, because what you just said was really powerful and beautiful. And whether it's if you want to polarize, say pro infighting, anti infighting, you know, realistically, I'm somewhere in the middle. Like, I think that there is a point for internal conflict and accountability that's going to happen. That's natural in an organization. That's healthy. And I grapple with then where is that line? And what you just described is a really compelling argument for at least just being accepting and I think better, if anything, we just accept that and not bother pushing back. Like, when we see that, when someone comes in, they're new and they have, you know, some powerful negative reaction or big criticism, or they want to come in and change a bunch of things, then we just give them the space to stay, and we generally don't react. Because I think if, you
sure,
know, if you're, if
it.
You know,
it's,
okay.
Or it's the perception. It's if the person, you know, the person who's getting loud about whatever it is they're passionate about and finally coming out of their shell is talking to somebody who's going to take it personally and become combative, that's when you get in an unhealthy argument. But I don't see that. Like you said, there's an acceptance. You let them talk, you let them get it out, and you know, you either talk about it then or later and bring up points where maybe they were right or wrong. And yeah, they're really
enlightening. Well, I can tell you where I think, because I agree with Mike. I probably sounded like I didn't for a minute there. Where I think part of the problem is sometimes people will take a disagreement like you just ran over their dog and their grandmother at the same time.
Yep.
And we've got to be careful to criticize ideas and not people.
Yep. Yes.
And if we make that clear, that is very healthy.
Nonviolent communication.
Okay.
If you don't know,
I would never say to somebody, you're not a libertarian, but I will say that idea you just communicated
yes.
isn't really a libertarian idea. And that's okay. I have some non-libertarian ideas. Don't attack people's identity.
Yeah.
Talk about the idea.
Yeah.
And that sometimes still that don't work because people will still flip out. Then that's on them. But there's too much in the party of attacking persons.
Yeah.
And they go, well, you
that's
know,
a clear line.
And then, but there's then the other thing is where they go, you can't attack ideas because we're a big tent. No, we're a big tent for people. All people
yeah.
are welcome. But our ideas are circumscribed by the statement of principles.
And we should be constantly subjecting them to scrutiny and trying to poke holes in them and subjecting them to that healthy debate. But Mike, I want to challenge you and turn it back to you. How do you connect this to policy and leadership of the party?
Well, as I've grown through my own discovery of my own agency, and when we kind of, the part that Caryn and I missed when I kind of went into the beginning of my resume as chair of Outright, it was my job to figure out why we weren't connecting with gender and sexual minority people. It was my job to figure out how do I build this bridge and how do I invite people across it? And I guess the assumption was that I was going to run out there and tell transgender people why they should get their genitals inspected by business owners because somehow their genitals became property when it walked through their door. And guess what? That's not right. So I had to turn that critique internally. And as I started understanding, why is this narrative? How did that even become normal? And I discovered what was behind the paleo wall, and I discovered that was the poor shaming behind the classist idea that poor people deserve to be poor. And there were presentation norms, and there goes respectability politics, and there goes the audacious caucus. And it was like a Russian doll of like inverted narratives that needed to be pushed back internally for me to succeed as chair of Outright. And so as I discovered my voice, it led me through a series of, quote, combative, and that's why there's this cartoon version out there of this, like, evil commie who just wants to fight with everybody. That is completely not who I am. But granted, like, I just explained to you, like, when you're new and discovering your voice, you know, there were some awkward moments.
You want to tell
some
embarrassing story?
Right. No. Let me finish my thought, though. But I'm mature now. Because I've been doing this for, over a decade now. Which brings us to the bottom unity narrative. Like,
yes.
I finally got to the point where I was like, okay, you know what? There are too many of us to ever be right. Not only are there, like, you know, thousands of us, but there's 7 billion actual people on the planet. We're not ever going to agree. So we need, you know, and now that, like, I'm not only more mature, but also wiser, and as some people have said, Machiavellian, this framing optics narrative, right? So there needs to be a frame around that so-called infighting that's like positive, right? So bottom unity is that narrative. So now you touched on that big tent thing, and I want to take that sort of analogy. So the tent, yeah, we're a big tent, but a tent has walls and
right.
it's constrictive. But what if we were a campground where there's like tents, but we're sharing a space, sort of like maybe, what is it called? Like Jack, Well,
it's called Starchild's idea of a convention.
There's that too. But like, think of, is it Jackfest?
Yes.
Is it Agorist? Jackrabbit? What is it?
Yeah, Jackalope.
Jackalope Freedom Festival.
Yeah.
So instead of a big tent where we're all trapped in there, we're like, we have to be like the single tent. It is more like a campground, so it can expand, and suddenly there goes, you know, there are the agorists, and there are the classical liberals, and there are the constitutional conservatives, and there are the ANCAPs, and there are the LibSox, and we can share a space. We're not trapped within it. It can expand or flex, and Caryn is absolutely right. There are boundaries around what counts as anti-authoritarianism and not. And the bottom unity narrative has kind of allowed for an expanded campground without actually ceding ground to authoritarianism. And it has really kind of transformed like my work, because I'm no longer like, I don't need to like split hairs over like, you know, is the Constitution really minarchist or not? The answer is it's not.
It's
but,
not.
But whatever, it's the framework we got, and like, okay. You know, and so I find myself suddenly defending people in comment threads that I used to fight with. And I see other people like coming to one another's defense and even tag teaming each other. Like when we run into these status in a thread, if someone's like kind of, if I find myself like with an open-minded constitutional conservative, but I know that like the next thing I say, they're gonna smell like social justice warrior on me or something, I could tag in, you know, someone like you, and you would be able to, like, you just smell more right wing, you just do, you know what I mean? And that's okay, you know? Or like,
he's,
let's say
like
that you were,
it's the tie.
Right, let's say that you were encountering like an AOC progressive type, but you, they clearly have anti-authoritarian leanings and they're on the verge. But you know you smell right wing.
You say that.
To you. All right.
So you can tag me.
Hold on. You're getting it. All right. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. So I want to.
Your scalp is flushing.
All right. So I want. Yeah. Right. I really like your strategic analysis. It reminds me a lot of what we learn from leftist coaches back organizing with the Iraq Veterans Against the War, you know, like 2004, 2006, 2007 timeframe. And if anything, I think we need more of that movement, bigger picture, coalition building, strategical analysis. Your fundamental pitch to the LP, though, for chair, and you brought this up the first time you told me that you were jumping the race, was let's have a variety of representation as the chair, or however you said it, something representing from the left. That seems like a hard sell. What's your pitch on that?
Well, tactically, what we're seeing is that working class people in general, those anxieties are bubbling to the surface and they're pissed. And they want something different, and populism is rising, and we saw that's, there goes Trump, right? Well, Trump turned out to be a big frickin' disaster. Am I allowed to cuss on here?
Sure.
A fucking disaster.
Huge.
And so now, they're like
the best, the biggest, the best, the best fucking disaster.
It was huge, huge.
The best words.
Right.
The biggest words.
Oh my God, it's awful. Like, he's gonna like tweet a nuclear bomb literally at somebody. Like, it's bad. Right? And so they're like kind of looking, so they're like, okay, I'm gonna turn to the left because they only get two choices. The control choice is, oh, well, right wing populism didn't work, so we're gonna turn to left wing populism. And like, that's what you can see on the horizon. And I just feel like if we have a left libertarian narrative that can hopefully compete with and resonate with those people, then now is the moment to like deploy that. Right? And so the bottom unity sort of narrative is like perfectly timed and positioned to take advantage of that. But like the problem for us is that it's still too new, right? So that's a powder keg that could easily blow up. There are some like fractures that like we just recently lived through a really combative 2018 chairperson's election that was very stereotyped around fascists versus commies, and you know what I mean? Like,
all right, Sarwark versus Smith, and now they're working together, right?
Stop. You're gonna pick the wound. Don't pick the wound.
No, but I'm pointing out that it's healed.
Okay, good. Because it's healed.
Like, to the point earlier that most drama in the movement is overblown.
It is, and it's so 2 years ago, like,
They're working together, and they're part of a team now.
Well, there's a fine line between something. A passionate debate and an argument. So even calling it fighting is all in whoever.
Yeah, I don't like that language. I have to like not saying we. Like, let's not say attack. Let's say be critical. You know.
I've got a comment about Mike's comments about reaching out to the left and what a powder keg. I do. What I consider is opposition research, so I read what they're writing on Jacobin.com. You know, I read things that Adolf Reed writes that's gonna piss off any mainstream Hillary supporter because he calls them on their shit. I also listen to this socialist podcast called Chapo Trap House. And as far as celebrities inside the United States, with a cult following who are overtly Marxist, these guys are the biggest ones. I listen to them just because it's insightful. They're funny. That's the main reason why I like it. They're funny, but they do present a Marxist viewpoint. And the other day I was listening to them, and they said, if you want to destroy class consciousness in this country, which in our language means attract people away from Bernie and AOC, all you have to do is listen to our show and have some kind of coherent response for the real issues that we're talking about that these idiot mainstream Democrats and Republicans are not touching on. What they literally said was, this is how you draw all of our supporters to your camp. So I agree with you, man.
Well, I want to change subjects, but cover a couple of things first. I mean, Mike, I'm really glad that you're running. I'm really happy to give you a platform for this because, I think a lot of people either see the Mohawk or hear anything that, or smell anything that smells of the left. there's a reaction. And every time then I take the time and I've interviewed you, I don't know, two or three times so far, and every time I'm just shocked by how much sense you make, and I want to make sure that one way or another the party listens to you in 2020, and here's I'm looking forward to chairs debates. Are there going to be any before national? I hope some of the state conventions.
I think we're going to be debating in California and Florida.
Awesome. Very much looking forward to that. We'll be live streaming or recording if that's not already being done. That'll be available online one way or another. I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, me too.
Caryn, for the secretary's race, are you running for re-election? I hope.
Of course I am.
Okay, excellent. Any competition?
None announced, but I expect that Alicia will be running again.
Okay. And this is Alicia Mattson, who you defeated in the last race, who has been working well on the LNC.
She's at large right
member,
now.
Mm-hmm. Right? Okay, excellent. So I wanted to go back to Zach about, because I was saying, I've heard you talk about the Libertarian Party of Cuba and Venezuela half a dozen times, and every time I consider a different angle, but even just hearing you introduce yourself on this podcast, I'm considering for the first time, like, wow, what is the relationship between the oppression that they're facing, the success that we're going to, that if we have here, if we develop, if we have a breakout year, if we have more mainstream acceptance, if we're able to channel resources or just change the global expectation, like, okay, hey, in America, they are considering a third party now. There are three, like, the world view of America changes from it's a duopoly to they have a viable third party. Does that mean less people get killed in these countries for their activism? Does intervening there, what's the relationship to these synergistic processes, and how should that influence our work, activism in the United States?
Well, first thing that people could do to get more involved in helping move along the libertarian movements in Venezuela is to make friends with people who are capital libertarians. There are a number of them who speak English, and yeah, I would also encourage people in our party to learn Spanish because, number one, you can communicate with our libertarian brothers all across Latin America. There are capital L libertarians in most countries of South America now, including countries to which some of our founding Cuban libertarians have escaped so they don't get whacked. But things like Kyle Varner is doing, he's a doctor by trade. That's his day job. So whenever he's got a few days or a few weeks off, he goes to the Colombian border with Venezuela, and he does pro bono work at a refugee clinic. Other people in this party, we've got over 100,000 Venezuelan exiles who are living here in the United States, and they're all over the place, not just Miami, not just New York, not just Los Angeles. You've got these little Venezuelan enclaves popping up in places like Kansas. There are Venezuelan communities here in Arizona. So wherever LP members are, I mean, at this point, if people have been here for more than 6 months, they're going to know some kind of English. why don't we befriend these Venezuelans that are in, you know, if people are watching this from outside of the country, there's also Venezuelan exiles in Europe and Asia. As a matter of fact, just a couple of weeks ago, I got sent a photo. One of my friends from LP Nevada, Jared Lord, was in Thailand having beers with one of my friends from the Libertarian Movement of Venezuela. And I said, number one, that's insane. But number two, that's awesome. Befriend some of these libertarians, teach them skills that they have not been able to learn in their country. You don't want to get involved in anything like Boogaloo. That's cool. Why don't you take them to the range? You know, take them to the shooting range, teach them, let them have that skill, and let them make the decision privately of how they are or are not going to apply that. If they're
this is Zach's secret plan to raise a militia, really. What's really going on?
You don't even need
to. We're
going
to bring in the Contras.
No, we're definitely not going to bring it to the Contras, but the thing is, we don't
we're gonna build
need
a big
to
igloo.
Have a big old American army in Venezuela. There are literally thousands of Venezuelan soldiers in exile right now who refuse to obey Maduro's orders, who they're just waiting around for some leadership. You know, they haven't gotten it from Guaido, which he's the guy who's headed the legitimate government, but his family is too busy skiing in the Austrian Alps and having a good time with the American aid money to actually end the crisis. If somebody would just, you know, give them the materials that they need to continue just sending small units in there to do what they have to do, that is a very important part of the process. And this is how we can apply some libertarian theory, because there are a lot of great libertarian thinkers who have written theory about how defense and self-defensive warfare and this concept of people's war, which, you know, Mao Zedong did not coin that phrase. Charles Leigh coined that phrase back during the American Revolution, because that was the successful method of combat, was literally people's war, individuals coming together in groups just on instinct because, hey, you know what? There are people who are coming here to kill us. If we can empower other people, give them the skills that they need, if we want to, as individuals, make commitments to help them in more substantial ways, you know, you can do everything from, you know, send $20 to our nonprofit to what Kyle does, actually go to Colombia and help refugees, because they accept a lot of other volunteers, you know, to help out with other tasks. There are members of the American LP who are teaching people how to shoot, and there are other members of the American libertarian circles and other circles who are kind of privy to the Venezuelan thing, who are lobbying people on Capitol Hill to give the Venezuelans their refugee status. Because one thing that is absolutely horrible is a lot of Cubans and Venezuelan refugees who actually have a legitimate reason for wanting to leave those countries for fear of their life are getting arrested by Customs and Border Patrol, ultimately because the current administration and the people who voted for them are just plain tired of having to press one to speak English. Well, I'm sorry that the First Amendment inconveniences you, and also the capitalistic theories of learning a goddamn trade language so you can make more money. I'm sorry, that's also offensive to you. You know, sorry, but there are so many things that we as individuals could do. So one thing I want to get clear, I am not advocating for the CIA to get involved in Venezuela. If this was a CIA operation, it would have been over with already. What I'm advocating for is for we as individuals to kind of imitate what a lot of American leftists did in Spain. I'm not saying all these Americans have to go down there, but there are a number of Americans who are interested in going as volunteers just to apply these ideas that we were raised
on. If you wanted to, like, kind of cowboy up and go to one of these places where Libertarian Party activists are facing this kind of direct violent oppression, do you feel that as a U.S. citizen in that situation you'd have some sort of bullshit aura of protection as the American there, that they're not going to mess with you, that you can provide accountability?
There,
like, should we be sending,
if there were American
paratroopers
volunteers on the ground, yes, they would have that aura of being Americans, but that's among people who hate the regime, whereas, you know, the people who are for the regime because they have to serve in the militia to get that box of food for their family, you know, those people are going to put a target on the Americans' backs.
You think an American going to one of these countries now to do libertarian activism is more likely to get killed there, or just as likely to get killed there as any of the local citizens?
At this point, yes, because, well, first of all, I got to, for context, Venezuela is a colony of Castro's Cuba right now. There actually are, not only is the Cuban ambassador sitting in on all of Maduro's cabinet meetings offering his 2 cents, but you actually have Cuban troops inside of Venezuela in Venezuelan uniforms. So what the United States has been to Afghanistan for the last 18 years, that's exactly what Cuba is to Venezuela right now. So As an American libertarian, you would probably be in a lot of danger inside of that country.
So what you're saying is the CIA should be involved.
Yeah,
no.
I'm fucking with you.
Well, see, I know you're messing with me, but there's a lot of folks in the movement who really believe, you know, with all their heart, that I am a CIA shill. And again,
you're
I'm
not?
Telling them, based on my experience, no, I'm an ex-shill for the military-industrial complex, but I was not a member of that.
Yeah, you left that part
club.
Of your resume out.
I am a former reserve soldier and former private military contractor, and honestly, despite the bullshit, I had a lot of fun until one day I just had to make a decision on certain moral disagreements.
All right, Zach, final thoughts? Any websites you want to plug?
CubanLibertarians.org, that's the Mises Mambi Institute, Cuba's Mises Institute. That's where you're going to find the news about what's going on in Cuba and Venezuela, and that's also where you're going to find cool translations of news articles in Spanish that maybe are not available here, libertarian articles that are coming out from Spanish thinkers, articles that our Cuban libertarian brothers wrote, and also you can catch videos there. Some of these videos are a lot of fun and charming, like the videos of the Cuban libertarians hosting a King's Day celebration. So we do Christmas over here. Down there, they do Day of the King, which is, you know, the King of Spain gave everybody a present like Santa Claus. So there's, you know, events that they do with the kids. But then there's other videos we have, like the hard evidence of the Maduro regime deploying. Here's the story. Well, there's a lot of really hard shit there, man. So if you've got the stomach for it, CubanLibertarians.org.
All right. Thank you very much, Zach Foster, ladies and gentlemen. All right. Mike Shipley.
So the best way to follow me and keep up to date with things is through my Facebook page. So look for Mike Shipley for LNC Chair on there. It's facebook.com/MikeStir4Liberty.
He will let you vent there.
I have a website. It's MikeShipley.com, but it's still under construction because all of my volunteers and my team are busy coaching me not to fight with.
He's a uniter, not a divider.
Right. No, I really am. But that does happen.
All right. Mike Shipley, ladies and gentlemen. And G.I. Mary Jane Joie Leigh.
It's really easy. GI dash the one in the middle, not the one on the bottom. GIMaryJane.com. That's got info to everything I've got my hands in. Real simple.
All right. Joie Leigh, ladies and gentlemen. And finally, Caryn and Harlos.
So what are you asking me now?
Final thoughts, sign-offs.
Final thoughts.
Save rounds.
Missed that part.
I know,
well,
that part.
I am.
Well, if anybody wants to squeeze in here, like, I just don't want to hold anybody too late.
Oh no.
It's a long day for everybody. But no, I can't. I can see you.
I know. I'm getting you up.
This is exactly what she does in meetings.
Yeah, I know. And then Nick shuts me down. But after this, I got something that I want to run by you. So for final thoughts, websites, etc., I do have two YouTube projects. I have the Pink Flame of Liberty, but I just started a new one, which is called The Cult of R&R, and it's a very irreverent, humorous look of Roberts, and it's. We're looking to invade the priesthood because in the Libertarian Party, there's a certain sacred
it's
class.
Rough messaging.
Certain sacred class of people who they use Roberts as a way to silence everybody else
right.
rather than to protect rights. So we're trying to, we view ourselves as like the Martin Luther bringing the scripture to the unwashed masses, translating it in English. So a friend of mine,
America needs, more Roberts
that,
rules of order.
No, we're doing daily devotionals. Roberts.
Very cool.
So, and I'm using that kind
chicken
of
chicken soup for the libertarian soul.
To study for, I'm going to, for the next level or whatever, just to, you know, shock the respectable people. But yeah, so those are the two projects I've got going on, and the Big L Libertarian Podcast.
All right, Caryn Harlos, ladies and gentlemen. Vermin, can we get a smash the state out of you while you're here?
Hey, while we're at it, why not smash the state?
And that's all the time we have for tonight. Thank you so much for joining us on Adam versus the Man to our live studio audience. Woo! If you only knew how stoned they all are right now. Thank you so much for joining us. Peace and love, y'all.
Adam vs. the Man is made possible by people who care about freedom, like our Patreon supporters whose monthly contributions get them perks and exclusive content. Find out how you can help by going to patreon.com/Adam vs. the Man.